when I submitted the talks, Carl's idea was that it would be handy to put them in a row, also because it more or less is a continuous story followed up by Idris' talk about the Oriental Tech project and what happens in there. The thing is a bit that if you look at the description of the topic, it's not an easy topic. Tech pipe building stuff is non-trivial. So what I've done is I've sort of made a summary of what we have, or basically what at our end we have reached so far with the LuaTech project, which somehow in its current state ends up or culminates at what Idris needs for his work. So the pipe builder will come along during the talk. Okay, let's wrap up what we have done so far. I think that we can safely say that tech can do a lot. I think it can do even more than you, if you first start using it, think it can do. And this is not really a surprise. Tech is a programming language, so you can basically program solutions. And because it has some hooks for extensions, think of specials and rights and whatever, you can go on extending it to some extent by using external applications. At my work, I've been using Tech for quite some time now. Most of the things that I do is direct XML to PDF processing. So if you, a lot of the things that are coming up in this talk might relate to the kind of work I'm doing. So we go from XML to PDF, which is not the most, to be honest, not the most challenging part of the job, because most of those documents are rather stupid. The nice things I do with Tech and Show is Tech I basically done in my spare time and on products that are absolutely not related to my work. Actually, it's the users who are the most demanding. It's not so much my work which is demanding if it comes down to tech. So, a couple of years ago, I had reached this moment that you say, well, I can do basically anything I want with tech. Do I need anything else? Actually, it was even the time that given the things that are happening in the world of publishing, you can start thinking about, should I quit using tech? Because is it still needed? Is high quality still, typesetting still needed? Anyhow, I use it in my daily work, and you have to program some solutions. Solutions did become a bit more complex, not so much because of typographic needs, but mostly because of strange things they wanted to do. And it became even annoying to a certain point. That you say, I have to implement something, and lots of code. You know you can do it. It doesn't look beautiful. Do I really want to do it this way? We had some examples of challenging code in the context code base, like typesetting tables in the HTML way, which is kind of tricky because tech only works in one of the two directions, horizontal or vertically, and not in two at the same time. Or doing advanced backgrounds behind running text, crossing pages, which is also not something that tech likes to do because it doesn't have a concept of a page and definitely not of backgrounds. Then there is thinking about those users, the issue of all these input encodings. Each language has its own particular input encoding. And it's possible to implement all these ways, but it's not always fun. And it somehow there's a tendency to interfere. So to come back to my work again, where we are dealing with automated typesetting and basically unattended automated typesetting, where processes have to run for years and you're producing tens of thousands of pages without even looking at them. Well, you need a stable solutions, predictable solutions, and that's not always tech's strong point, unless you go to some extent in programming. But it can be done, and as said, it was still possible that way. And then I ran into Lua. Probably most of you know that I used to use some of the Lua extensions in the editing programs that we used. And that was the moment when I started thinking about, wait a minute, we can extend tech in such a way that it can become fun again to write complex solutions. Okay, so what was the first things that could be done? We could, I'm one page too far. The first thing we could do is, and what I'm more or less talking about now is as I see at least, is tech for the next 10 or 20 years. What will happen after that, I don't know. Input encoding, one of the tricky things. Okay, we are in here in the English language area, so it's not so much an issue here, but in Europe this is a big issue. Input encoding is no longer handled at the tech end. We could throw it out completely, basically all the code, because we could use input filters. And all users somehow switch to UTF anyway, so why bother? Mixed font encodings could also go. Fonts is a nightmare in tech. And we could kick out all the font encoding stuff. I'm talking about context mostly now. And it also means that quite some of the weird hacks that you have in your code can go away. So it's a simplification. There's no longer a relationship between font encodings and hyphenation. I don't know how many users are aware of that, but those two mechanisms are quite closely related. In the math department, everything has gone Unicode, as Will already mentioned this morning. So we kicked out all our mixed math encodings and replaced it by Unicode. I'm not mostly talking about LuaTeX, of course, because, for instance, if I would do the same thing in XeTeX, I would probably still use or need to use some of the old stuff, but we quit using that. By the time that we were thinking about these issues, we also decided that the wisest thing was to freeze context, to say, okay, this is where we stop with the old stuff, and that's where the new stuff starts. And I think, in retrospect, that was a very good decision. It saves me a lot of time not to maintain the old stuff. It works quite well for users, and it gives a pretty nice benchmark. So you have a sort of standard implementation. If you re-implement everything from scratch, basically, then you know what you have to achieve. But it's still there, and it's still used somehow. There are also things that, if you talk about such a new engine, that are changing in more fundamental way. And I will give some examples later of how we do these kind of things. For instance, in tech you always have this multiple path system. You do a job and then you write some stuff to an external file which is used in the following run, like tables of contents generation or index generation or cross-referencing. And all that kind of stuff is gone. We now maintain all this data in Lua data structures, which means that we have access to it at any time we want, and we can carry out much more information. It also means that all the low-level code has been rewritten for that. Initialization is another important issue. You have lots of characters and symbols and things like that. Everything is defined in a more abstract way using a database, and we generate basically the tech commands and everything related from that. So for instance, characters, we have a large character database, which is information about all the characters and its properties, has information about it being mass characters or not, and we generate everything from that. We don't do that anymore in tech code, which is much better maintainable. Everything related to structure is now supported by Lua code. And this has actually a quite large impact on the whole system, also in terms of, well, trying to make it compatible. If you rewrite all this code and you have this working system there, well, users say, well, this used to work, it doesn't work anymore. You have to explain that they have more control. And that then you say, okay, I need to provide some backward compatibility, so you add, again, a compatibility layer, things like that. But in the end, I think this whole subsystem is completely new, with much more control. because well, structure is a broad topic. So you don't only have sectioning, you have everything related to numbering, like floats and whatever, footnotes. I think virtually everything in the macro package relates somehow to structure. So everything is touched. In practice, it means that 50% of the context Mark IV code is Lua and no longer TeX. Float, for instance, float management, also one of those areas. If you have documents with, let's say, 500 images, you somehow need to manage them. You need to make sure that they end up on the right spot. This can be done in TeX, but I'm now moving that code to Lua as well. Indexes, register management, similar topic. You have to sort things. Well, sorting can be done in any programming language, and if the language is part of the engine, then it becomes easier. There are some very specialized topics, like swapping cases, making things uppercase or lowercase, or making sure that in tables or wherever the digits has equal width, or maybe special language-related kerning, like the French, you have some spacing before and after certain characters. They're all delegated to the Lua code. And we do that by manipulating node lists and carrying out attributes. I will show that later. Hyperlinks, yet another topic. There is some primitive support in PDF. Actually, I never really used much of that, only a few things. And everything is now, I don't use anything of that anymore. I just handle hyperlinks and cross-referencing everything at the Lua end by manipulating, parsing, whatever the intermediate node list before they end up in the final documents. It means also that I have a bit more flexibility. Something that, for instance, Ross mentioned, this structured PDF. So far, I've only looked at it, never done with something with it because nobody requested it. But it's typically something that I would completely program in Lua and not in primitives or whatever. Well, numeric conversions, of course, is a good candidate. Graphics. I'm not saying that these are things that cannot be done by TeX, but it's easy to do it at the other end. Normally, if an image is embedded, you want to know what's its type. You have to control the backend. You have to do some scaling. You have to locate the thing on disk. All that stuff is done in Lua. Everything related to spacing, horizontal and vertically. There are some horizontal spacing issues. I will show that an example of that are done in Lua. And the vertical spacing is also being re-implemented, so we now use a more advanced model for vertical spacing with weighted breakpoints, things like that. Of course, and this is something for a later talk, MetaPost support is completely delegated. That is due to the fact that we use the MetaPost library, and that means that runtime for that kind of stuff is reduced to virtually zero. Good example is, for instance, the Metafun manual. Maybe some of you have seen that. One, it has some 1700 graphics, and it processes in 30 seconds, including all the graphics, including some 4 times call out to other instances of TeX. And that used to be 10, 20 minutes. So it means that this has large consequences for maintaining a manual. Yeah? It's no fun to maintain a manual if it takes 10, 15 minutes to run. And if it takes 30 seconds, it suddenly becomes, interesting again. Context always had mechanism for buffering data. You could buffer data, you could move it around, you could call it upon different places in your document. Everything now happens in memory instead of in files. Verbatim, another one of those tricky areas of TeX. The nice thing, well, verbatim itself is not a problem. Verbatim is a problem because you want to type the TeX manuals with TeX, then therefore it's actually a problem. And, again, delegated to Lua. We have a couple of experimental features. These are the things that I referred to in the beginning of the talk, like they say, okay, do I still want to do this in TeX or do I want to do it in a different way? There are some things that I started doing, like multiple parallel streams in documents, things like that I will no longer develop them in traditional TeX, but I will do that only in the Mark IV way, and there are some experiments with that. You get a couple of things for free. One of them is that you suddenly have a scripting language on board, so you are no longer dependent on external programs. The whole thing, including all the tools that we use, is now done in Lua. And because TechLive ships LuaTech, every distribution automatically ships all the tools that you need. You no longer depend on installing anything else. You don't need Perl on your machine, or Ruby, or whatever. Another thing with quite some impact is that I'm talking about already 4 years ago, we started doing these kind of things, that all file I/O is no longer dealt with by the Capaci library. I've written my own variant of that. And so we can do things like reading from zip files, reading from URLs, accessing FTP files, things like that. And that's a bit more flexible than waiting for something that will never happen. Because I still remember in one of the Dante meetings, the discussions about extensions to Capaci and whatever. I don't know where it was, 4 or 5 years ago. Nothing ever came out of that. And I'm not going to wait for that. It's not going to happen. So in theory, it should be possible to run context from a zip file. That's the whole idea. One of the first things that they implemented was, or re-implemented actually, was XML support. Context also always has XML parsing and processing on board. It was a good exercise in Lua to do that completely in Lua. And it's integrated in such a way that we can access XML files completely in an arbitrary way. The trees we can access this. We have a sort of XPath path-like language on board. And it's used, has always been used actually, for certain things like image databases that were part of the context kernel. But you can also imagine that there's now an experimental mechanism where, for instance, take BibTeX. We just load a BibTeX file. I convert it into an XML structure, and I can use all the machinery that I have for accessing every node in every way by just using XPath like requests. And it works quite well, I think. That's one of the things that we need for our work, actually. Not the BibTeX, but the XML. Processing context was always done with a runner script. You have something called TechExec that processed your file. It would take care of multiple runs if needed. That's no longer done with TechExec, the Ruby script, but with context, the context script, which is actually a Lua script, which runs on top of the LuaTeX engine. So basically, LuaTeX. Oh. Is this power supply not on? So the battery is less than half an hour. Okay. So that has always been delegated to Lua. We don't need other programs. I think BibTeX was the only external program that was used by bibliography module, but that we don't need it anymore. The whole toolkit that comes with context has been rewritten, so there are quite some scripts. I think in this respect we helped people like Carl by making it easier. Less dependencies, easier. There's quite some, and that's part of the development history of LuaTeX. There's quite some tracing and debugging on board. It teaches me a lot about what tech actually does. After that many years, I still run in a lot of situations. Well, interesting, never knew it was doing this kind of. So we have really a lot of debugging and things on board. And there are other big changes, like we move more stuff into the kernel, like chemical typesetting, things like that. This is a step up to the next part. One of the driving forces behind the project is what Edith will talk about, Oriental Tech Project. And I will not spend much words on that, but it's actually one of the fun parts of the whole thing. And we have lots of plan. plans. There is a lot of experimental code in Context Mark 4 that I'm now cleaning out, removing, simplifying, because LuaTeX evolves. You suddenly see things like, oh yeah, well, that's really old code, needs to go. Yeah. Maybe some code is not even doing anything anymore. And this is still an exercise. Yeah, this is still, we still haven't touched the real interesting and hard things. So we will, at some point, start doing more complex things. And I think the consequences for Context as a system means that each subsystem will be touched, will be completely rewritten, basically. But it's a stepwise process. You need to be able to run the old stuff, and so you cannot do everything at once. So there will be, for instance, be additional mechanisms for advanced font usage. We want to go a bit beyond open type, things like that. Language-specific typesetting is still an area where a lot of work can be done. Mass. I know probably most people here will not use Context, and definitely not its mass, but there are the users who do have quite some demands, and I think we will end up with a more specialized sub-machineries. A bit like what OpenMass project did with these areas and fields and dictionaries and things like that. The basics are there. We can use it. We have already made it part of the database. It's just a matter of time before it shows up. The long-term plan is that we want to have everything more modularized, so that I can basically say I want to construct a new, let's say, typesetting system. Like I want to make a specialized version of Context doing this or that, and that project is called MetaTech, and it basically means isolating all the individual components. This is not non-trivial, because in tech and typesetting, a lot of things are pretty closely related. But you can imagine that at some point you have a machinery that doesn't see any tech input anymore, just Lua or XML or whatever. Anything we can dream of will probably happen, so we'll be busy for a while. Okay, I will now show some examples. A bit small screen. Oh, okay. It scales a bit funny on my screen. Okay, I mentioned caching, for instance. This is one of the areas where tech has always been a bit hard to beat. Like, there is this uppercase and lowercase stuff, but it operates in a sort of strange way, and it's very hard to use it to have a piece of your text and say, I want to uppercase this piece of text. There is some expansion going on. There is some. Well, I won't bother you with the details, but it can interfere basically, especially if there are commands in there, with everything you can imagine. So, in Context Mark 4, we don't use any tech mechanism or primitive or whatever kind of support anymore. I just tag it. I tag it with an attribute and say this needs to be upper or lowercase or whatever. And eventually, when the characters end up in the node list, at some point they intercept that code, that list, and then I manipulate that list directly. So it means that you can have far more easily this kind of nest stuff. Now you may wonder, why is it needed? Well, normally it's not needed, but we work mostly for educational publishers, and those are not really the most simple documents, and well, anything you can think of will show up there. So this kind of crap really happens. Yeah, so it actually comes out okay. So there's basically hardly any tech code involved in there, just tagging. Normalizing is another example. If you have tables, you'll be surprised about the weird font specifications you can get from designers. And well, in most cases, they don't know what fonts do or don't do. So often you need to do corrections. And examples of that are, you know, if you have these digits, they normally have an equal width. And it's not so much a problem if you have the normal variant, but if you have an old style variant, then you can have glyphs with different widths. So you can see this one is actually, it's hard to see maybe, but this is smaller. And if we apply the equal distance thing, it becomes wider again. Yeah. Again, this is something we just tag. There's an attribute carrying around with these specific, let's say characters, can basically be any character. And then at some point I intercept this stream and I say, okay, now I know that these are the digits and I can change them according to what's in the font. Again, absolutely no tech code involved. Mathematics, it's debatable, but in school maths, if you talk about coordinates, you don't want spacing after the comma. So again, all maths is intercepted at some stage, at the intermediate know-what stage, and at that point we can manipulate it any way we want. There are mechanisms available for that. So it means that in your document, you can make it part of your document specification, and then you don't have to add all kinds of funny spacing commands and so anymore. I want to get rid of all that kind of stuff. That's the idea. This is another one, compound words. Yeah, normally you can say, okay, I put some special code in there that tells tech that it may hyphenate at that point. But you can also imagine that you don't do that. So in this case, we just enable a mechanism, and the mechanism again at some point will intercept. There's a lot of interception going on. Yeah, will intercept this node list and will say, okay, this is a hyphen. It has been tagged somehow by this attribute, and let's hyphenate or create a discretionary node at that point that can be hyphenated. And some languages have differences. Yeah, you can, for instance, replicate it there. This is what we control with types. Yeah, so you can have basically, if you know what the problem is, you can somehow solve it. That's my idea at this point with this kind of stuff. Of course, you always need ways to block it, because there are situations where you don't want it to happen. Then we come at things like the French like. If there are macro writers here, and I know that there are a couple of them, that then you probably know that what the trick for the. It comes next. I will first mention this one. If you have a bunch of characters and you want to space them, and this often happens in titles and things like that, then one way of dealing is writing a small parser that picks up the characters and then, okay, I put it here, put a space after it, another character, more space after it, things like that. That doesn't really work well with the other languages. If you have French or German or whatever, you often have something like backslash, double quote, and then a character or whatever. So where does your parsing end and start? It's already easier if you have, let's say, UTF, because then the character is one entity. So this is something that will, in most cases, if you have an unattended workflow, an automated, if you do it manually, you can do everything. But if you have something that has to happen automatically, you don't know what gets in, then you can't rely on parsing. So again, we just mark a piece of text that it has to be spaced, so to say. Some part, I intercept the list. I analyze the list and put spacing before and after certain characters. You treat spacing in a certain way. This is actually an example which came up last week when I was preparing this. On the contact list, there was somebody said it fails on this word because this is a particularly nasty one, because it has in traditional tech, so to say, if you use the traditional in context, you can have two ways of getting your characters turned into glyphs, so to say. One is what we call base mode, which is a traditional way it will use a tech machine, or the other way is node mode, which will use Lua typesetting, as Idris will show later. This is processed in base mode, and then you have the tech machinery, which has a ligature, is basically two ligatures. It's the FF, and then it makes the FFL. So it's a chain thing. So in order to get the kerning between these ligatures and things like that, Well, you need a little bit more triggery, but okay, it's doable. You can because you don't want the ligature to you don't want A, FFL, or whatever, of FL, and then this one. Yeah, you want to get actually to get rid of ligatures. The most natural way to is turn off ligatures. You may wonder what ligatures are doing anyway in types of documents. I think it's mostly left over from some time. So related to this is another language issue, is that the French, they have these patient before characters. I was referring to that before. So they key in this, and they actually want some spacing around these guillemots. Now, what was the normal way of doing that? Make them active, yeah? And then the character is basically a macro. It might be able to look back and ahead. Depends a bit on the situation. And then it can in insert itself plus some spacing. And that's a nightmare. Not so much for guillemots, but it is really a nightmare if you're talking about, for instance, colons and semicolons. Because an active colon in the text is not so bad, but colons are used everywhere. They are used for instance, in cross references, yeah, where you may have something, chapter, colon, something. And so then you have to suppress the active stuff, and it really becomes messy. You can program it, but it's no fun. It's one of the areas, as soon as you have this mechanism, I could kick out a lot of code that was just there to take care of the odd cases. So in the France, in French, yeah, you put some spacing there. I've exaggerated it a bit. I found out that there are more languages that need it. Interesting is that the users never asked for it because they probably somehow could foresee that it was a nightmare. Yeah. So you can define any kind of, you can do it with any character. It's not hard coded. And again, the reason why I have this verbatim stuff in there, you don't want to do it in verbatim, yeah? So you want it only in a normal text and not in verbatim. There's always a complication. Yep. Yeah. Now we come to a couple of more extreme cases, yeah? Don't ask me why, but underlining is sometimes demanded. And again, this is something that is a bit tricky to do in tech. I'm not saying it's impossible. We could do it in Mark too, but because we have a rather advanced background mechanism, we can underline arbitrary text. But it needs MetaPost to run in the background. This doesn't. Yeah. This nicely crosses the lines. Not related to fonts. And of course, you can abuse mechanisms like this. This one is especially the next one is for Idris. This one is still for myself. You can also make backgrounds this way. It's not the normal way I do backgrounds, but you can abuse the mechanism to do it. You can even reverse the order and put it in front. Again, done by manipulating node lists. Here's another example. This one is actually for Idris because he wants to do advanced documents with lots of footnotes. So this is something where we reverse the thing. We don't put the footnote in the foot, but we put the footnote in the text, and then you need to cross the line. So you want to have raised text crossing lines, and again, this can be done. Okay, I actually had an extreme example. I still have 10 seconds, so I can probably show that. So you might wonder why do I need this underline? This is typically an example of a project that demanded underlining, and it didn't demand underlining. It demanded actually strike through, because it was needed to mark in a document which pieces were added, and which pieces were removed. So everything removed should be crossed through, and everything added should get green underlined. And then you get, because it's an automated flow and it's done in XML, whatever, it's unattended, it had to be applied to everything. You don't know where it's applied to. So this, so if you look at, let's, if you look at this, I start the underbar at the top, and I end it at the bottom, yeah, and everything in between gets underbarred. It's not related anymore. So the text of the pictures, the captions, whatever, tables. If you, these are really, there's no time to read the text, but this is really interesting stuff about California. In case you don't know it, somebody was referring to astronomy, yeah? How many people of you know that Pluto is no longer a planet? Right, and okay, and in California, it's still a planet. There are several reasons for that. Because, well, the industry here, yeah, so it will, this thing that cause trauma to the children if they remove it. Another one is that it will render textbooks, etc., obsolete. Yet another one is that they need Pluto to get rid of certain criminal elements, and they need a far-off place. It is really law, this, and etc., etc. New Mexico is different. New Mexico, there, it's Pluto is a planet if it crosses the sky of New Mexico. And well, this one is a special one I also like. I've put these examples in the context distribution, actually. You can think about what happens here. This is about what I wanted to do in the first half. Nice and fine.